I'm Tanya Fox, and you're listening to Fox Talks Business Podcast. I started my career in the corporate world, but always played to my own tune and loved to think outside of the box. This didn't always serve me well with the bosses, so I made the decision to become an entrepreneur. And that little seed of entrepreneurial curiosity continued to grow as I branched out into retail, service, and franchise businesses. Now, I have been fortunate to have amazing successes in the last two decades, but they did not come without some really big failures and even bigger lessons learned. And that's why I started this podcast, not just to share the failures, but to show you how you can turn every failure into a success. We're going to hear from some amazing humans from around the world that are going to share their stories of the good, the bad, and the motivational entrepreneurial life has to offer. After all, life is too short to make all of the mistakes yourself, so why not learn from each other? And of course, we're going to have some fun, because as I always say, well, you know what? I'll tell you that at the end of the episode. So thank you so much for joining me today, Jeremy. I'm so excited to chat with you today about all things legal.
Thanks, Tanya. Looking forward to it.
So before we jump into the sort of nitty-gritty of it, give us a little bit of background on how you kind of got to doing this for small and medium businesses.
Yeah. So I started out as a lawyer almost 20 years ago now. So we're recording this at the end of 2021, and it was about 20 years ago, I decided I wanted to do law, and I got into the field, and it was a long journey. I was working for a law firm over here in Brisbane, and decided that about 10 years ago that I'd start my own business. And the reason I did that was because I knew that I could do it better, right? Like we all do when we start our own business.
That's why we all do it, right? I could do this better.
of course. And you go in with that kind of mindset. And I learned really quickly just how hard running business was. And as I was acting for people, as I was handling their legal problems, I got more and more frustrated, Tanya, with people not being proactive with their legal problems. So they'd come to us and to solve a problem that could have been solved much cheaper for them and much easier. And really, it became a big frustration for me where, in one case, a client lost $1 million of other people's money, and another client lost nearly $2 million of his own money. And they didn't get legal advice because they thought it was too expensive. They didn't want to talk to lawyers. And it really became apparent to me that there was something broken in the system where we help lawyers help their clients to solve problems, but not to stop them from happening in the first place. So I really shifted my mindset to being that more proactive lawyer that then went into writing books and doing lots of other things as well. So it was really born out of frustration with what I see as a broken system.
Yeah. And I think that that's true no matter where you are. I mean, you're pretty much on the other side of the world for me, because everyone knows I'm in Canada. And but it's true. Like you don't think, oh, I should make sure that, I have a lawyer on my team. You think, I don't want to ever see the inside of a lawyer's office, if at all I can avoid it. Sort of like court, right? You're like, I never want to have to go to court.
That's right. And that's a huge problem, because there's so much that lawyers need to do to help business owners. And it's the same. You're in Canada, I'm in Australia. I've written my podcasts and my books and all the rest of that, Australia, Canada, the US and the UK, and the law is very similar, and it's a similar problem throughout all those countries, and it's a similar problem throughout the world, Tanya, really. But people just don't want to get legal advice for the reasons that you said, and it's quite frustrating.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about to help everybody who's sitting there listening going, no, don't want to have to deal with the lawyer. But let's talk about giving them a bit more of an understanding about why being proactive with the law is so important in business.
Yeah. Well, the first reason is it saves you lots of money. like if you're trying to solve a problem after it occurs, it's going to cost you a lot more money than trying to prevent it. It's that old, prevention is better than a cure, or, and there's lots of stuff that you're not aware of, the unconscious unawareness of law is huge out there. And I think part of the reason for that, and I've done this research around, you know, around the world really, is that people, one, they're afraid of what they see as a cost. They don't see it as an investment. They're worried about lawyers generally can be a bit abrasive. They use big words. They talk, some of them talk in a condescending way, and that turns people off, and to a point where people just go, I don't want to deal with that. And so why it's important is because it really saves you money, but it also stops you from a lot of failure in business, because you've solved those legal issues outright before they arise. And it's probably the most frustrating part about what I do is it's solving a problem that people don't see until it actually happens to them. And so, you know, knowing that you can solve those problems is something that a lot of people don't realize. So, you know, I'm all about educating people as to what they need to do so that they can go to their lawyer and get the advice that they need and solve those problems upfront.
So let's talk about just a few, if you can give us sort of a few examples of, you know, what are some of the things that people don't think about that they should be thinking about?
Yeah, we could be here all day talking about all of them.
Just a few. I know there's a ton, but just a few.
Well, the first one is their structure. So what structure they're going to operate their business through. So often, we call it barbecue advice here in Australia, where you go to a barbecue with your friends and you're talking about, I'm going to start this business. And your friend goes, oh, I set up this company or this structure or this thing. You should just do that. And people go, that sounds like a good idea. And what the problem with that is that there's no nuance in the advice. There's no like taking into account your circumstances with that advice. So people set up their structure in a way that someone else has done, and it may not be right for you. So yeah, that's the big one that I see, is startup businesses that just get that wrong because they want to save money. They want to save having to go and see a lawyer. They want to save all those things that we've talked about. So that's probably the first big one. The second one is when they're engaging with their clients for the first time. Yeah, we've all been there. Everyone who's started a business has been there. You want to get in and start doing the work. I know this. I've started three or four businesses over the years. You want to get in there. You want to start making money. And so you just go and sign up a client straight away. But what you don't do is engage with them properly. So you don't have any documentation that actually sets out the rules of the relationship. And that's all fine at the beginning. But 2, 3, 4 years down the track, when that relationship may change, it might sour a little bit, people's expectations change. The documentation doesn't, or the lack of documentation means that you can't go and enforce your rights. And it's really sad, Tanya, how many people come and see us who have, had this great relationship with a client for 10, 20, well, not 10, 20 years, but 2, 3, 4 years. And they, circumstances change or someone in the business changes and they can't enforce their agreement. So it's, those kind of things are really things that people miss out on early on in their business and ends up costing them a lot of money in the future.
Well, and I think there's a lot of people that just go, oh, whatever, like it's just too much of a pain in the butt to deal with, not realizing how much money you're actually, potentially leaving on the table. That's not getting in your pocket, because that's a common one. I agree with you that, you hear so often that people are like, somebody new came in and now they're just not paying me, so I guess I'm out. Right. And, because they think it's too much of a hassle to try to deal with it. It would cost me more, of thing.
Yeah. Hmm.
So what are some of, I think those are really good examples for people, because even, the first one that you were talking about, starting a business, I don't know how many times, and I've been down the road because I've owned franchise and retail. And so I've had to deal with a few different ways of opening a business. And I remember people just saying, we'll incorporate and then nobody can touch you. I kind of went, that's not true.
It sounds good though, doesn't it?
And doesn't it, right? Like if I just incorporate and pay a little bit of extra to do my taxes at the end of the year, if anything goes wrong, they can't come after me at all whatsoever.
Yeah. And that's a common misconception. And that was the original reason that companies were created, was to do that. But over time, as people take advantage of that and people lose money and do dodgy things, the law evolves to plug those gaps. Yeah. There's no such thing as a free lunch. I always say, and that's the same with the company. So yeah, that's why people need to get advice from a lawyer that knows this stuff, and even an accountant. you know, they don't give you the legal advice, but yeah, there are different tax structures around the world. You know, I've researched this stuff, and every country has a nuanced tax code and the rules around the what you need to do. So you need to get the advice to make sure that you're doing it properly. Otherwise, yeah, you'll get stuck in limbo down the track, and it'll cost you money. And so, I mean, that's the biggest reason for getting legal advice early, is that it'll save you money long term, and people don't realize that. So they just need to educate themselves better on what they need to do.
Well, and I think one of the points that you had brought up earlier is that people tend to feel overwhelmed because of, I remember even sometimes, you know, sitting in a lawyer's office and then talking to me and going, can you just back up and tell me this in normal English? Because I have no idea what you just said. Like, sounds like another language. But there's a lot of people who feel like they can't say that, right? Like, they feel like, I should know this. I should know what this means. Like, I mean, I've been in business for, you know, however many, 2, 3, 5 years. Like, I'm a pretty intelligent person. I feel like I should know these English words, but I just don't. And so talk a little bit about how you are helping to sort of change that in your language and in your resources.
Yeah, so it was one of the things that I really, when I wrote my book, the first one in Australia, was really deliberate with, was explaining legal terms in plain English. And so, yeah, everything that I do, everything that I write, every time that I speak, you know, I do a lot of podcast interviews, I do a lot of media, is all around explaining in ways that people can understand. And so it's really quite a deliberate practice. And the best compliment I got, Tanya, when I first published my book, I was doing a renovation of my house. And the foreman saw my books. You know, you get the boxes of books when you publish a book. And he saw them, and he goes, "What's that?" And I said, "It's my book." He asked what it was about, and I told him. And he goes, "I'll never understand that." I said, "Take it away and read it." And about a week later, he came back and said, "I actually now understand this stuff. I finally get it." And so that was probably the best compliment that I've got about the book. But it's all around just explaining things in plain English. It's about making sure that people understand and stopping to answer the questions that people have. And so we make a big effort of when we do, you know, interviews, when we do things with clients, we make sure that we listen for the questions and maybe things that people don't understand, and then work out a way to explain it for everyone. Because if someone's got a question, other people will have it too.
Yeah. So I'm going to put you on the spot right now. So talk to me about some of the questions that people commonly ask you, because I think there might be some people out there going, I don't know. I don't even know what I would ask. I don't know what I don't know.
Yeah. So that's a great question. So the first one would be, you know, like, why do I need to do all this? Like, why do I need to put agreements in place? And, you know, I kind of answered that before, and that's one of the reasons I raised it, was because that's a very common question. It's like, oh, can't I just solve that later? And so I sit down and explain to them, really, you know, do a cost analysis of why they need to go and get the advice. So that's probably the big one, is why do I need to do this now? And we've kind of covered that already, the reactive versus proactive. Another one would be, you know, like, you know, can I actually enforce these agreements? So often, you know, as a lawyer, people go, well, yeah, they hear on a TV show or from their friends, this agreement isn't worth the paper it's written on. You know, I don't know whether that's
okay. There's holes in it. There's always gray areas, and anybody can chew through any agreement you have. Yeah.
Yeah. And that can be true. And it really, the answer to that question comes down to really, understanding that no legal agreement can cover every situation, right? It just can't. Every contract would be 4,000 pages long if that was the case. And no one wants that, not even lawyers. And would cost an absolute fortune to put together. But what you've got to do is cover off on the most important things that might go wrong. And this is where my frustration with the legal profession comes in, because they'll just make assumptions about the problems that will happen and they'll put them in the agreement. Whereas they need to sit down and ask clients questions about what's in the business? Yeah, what could go wrong? What's in the relationship? What's the agreement that you have? What are the conversations that you've had to find those nuances where things could go wrong, and then make sure they're documented in an agreement? I like to, when I'm advising clients when I put my lawyer hat on, I like to say that an agreement is almost like a disagreement. It's about setting out the terms of what happens if you disagree. So there's some of the really big ones that I get often. There's a lot more, but there's some of the things that I get a lot. And I think that people can understand it if they just educate themselves on what they need to do.
And I think we're starting to see more and more of that because there's so many businesses that are going online. There's so many businesses that are offering things like, you know, large packages that are, a year. And I know because I've done some of this where you offer a year long package, somebody signs up, but they're paying monthly for it. And then all of a sudden, bloop, like the payments stop. Yep. Right. And so then you're just kind of like, okay, like what's going on? And I think that there's a lot of times that business owners are out there and they're like, but this is so, my clients are lovely. Like, I don't want to, I'm not going to have, people like that. And so I love what you're saying about, this isn't about like thinking about the worst case scenario all the time in your business. This is just making sure that when and if you do happen to hit that, you know what to do because it's all set out and you're not pulling your hair out and going, well, that's it. Like, let's just close the doors.
Yep, that's right.
So let's talk a little bit about your book. What made you, you talked a little bit about what made you decide to write this book, but talk a little bit more about what people can find in it and who it's for.
So it's for business owners. The tagline is from taking business from startup to success. But it's not just the startup business owners. I always make that point that it's for business owners. And I think the sweet spot is when you've been in business for a couple of years, because let's face it, no matter how many times I do interviews and we bang on about getting advice, people don't necessarily listen to that. And so they go and start their business. They can't afford it. And, in an age where you can start a business with a laptop and internet connection and an idea, that doesn't happen often. So, it's a great book for startup business owners, but it's also great for those businesses that have been around for a couple of years, where they've started to put systems in place for their business, where they've started to really prove out the model that they have a minimum viable product, they have something that people will buy, and they'll start to get advice. So what I've done is I laid out all the steps that a business owner needs to take from a legal perspective, and I laid it out into 13 phases. And just a quick side note, when I first started my business, I got a business coach, and he told me that I'd write a book one day. And I laughed at him and said, what lawyer writes a book, and who's going to read a book by a lawyer? And when I had those two matters that I talked about before, where I got really frustrated where the clients lost all that money and other people's money, I sat down and I was really frustrated, and I mapped out when successful business owners did things and when people that failed did things. And that's where I came up with the concept of the life cycle, by really looking at what people had done right and what people had done poorly, and mapped out 13 phases. And I had to ring him and say, you were right, because I had 13 phases, 13 chapters, there's a book. And so the book maps out what you need to do, why you need to do it. It explains it in plain English, and then also tells you who you need to talk to get that done. So it's not in every single case a lawyer. It could be an accountant in some cases. It could be a coach. It could be other types of consultants that you need to speak to. And so I map out all of the things that you need to do, and then who it is, because you can't do it yourself. And so I want to make sure that people can see that throughout the book. And I actually, Tanya, had a bit of a disagreement, we'll call it, with my publisher on this. He thought it was getting a bit too repetitive, with every chapter saying you need to speak to these people. But I pushed back and said, no, this is what people want. This is what people want and what people need. And it's one of the compliments I get from the book is that people go, now I understand what I need to do, why I need to do it, and who I need to help do it. And so that's what people will find in the book.
Well, and I think that this is an important resource for people, because like you said, it's so easy to start a business, and people are doing it, more and more these days. We're seeing a lot of like side hustles and stuff like that. Which I don't really like that term. Either you're in or you're in. There's no such thing as a side hustle. That's my thing. A business is a business. But I think that there's, I'm glad that you say that this is for anybody, even if they've already started, because I think sometimes people get far off and then they go, I've been doing this for a long time and it's kind of worked the way I've been doing it. Why change?
Yeah. Yeah, and there's always room for improvement, isn't there? Yeah, there's always room to we have the saying in one of the businesses that I work in, continuing a never-ending improvement. We call it. And there's always room for improvement, no matter what you're doing. And so, if you've been in business for a couple of years, you can still improve. You can still fix those legal holes in your business.
So let's talk a little bit about someone who's like, okay, I know I need to do this. I need to, sort of get on this. I'm interested in doing this, but I don't know the questions to ask. Because often people don't, and I know this because I also, like, one of my other hats is bookkeeping, and people often do not ask questions, right? They just go, yep. I don't know, like, somebody told me to go to this person and that's who I go to. And then they don't realize it until there's issues that are up. So what are some of the things that people should be asking when they're going? Because I always think you need to interview any professional person that you're hiring. So what are some of the key things that business owners should be asking when they're looking for a lawyer?
Great question. And I think that probably the most important ones come around, you know, their experience and also how they give their advice. So figuring out, you know, like, and you don't need a lawyer who's got 20 years experience, you know, someone who's just out could have great experience. So it's around, like, how many businesses have you acted for? And can you give me some examples of what you've done for them? And really finding that out. And another one that's a bugbear of mine is how do they charge? You know, Law is notorious for charging on time. And in my view, if you're charging on time, then you're either lazy or you don't know your subject area well enough. especially as a lawyer, if you know how to do the work, you should know what that advice costs. So, you know, finding a lawyer who will charge a fixed fee for advice, especially for an early stage business, you know, cash is often very, very tight for an early stage business. And so they should be able to give advice based on their experience, and they should know what it would cost to do that advice. So, you know, asking about their experience and getting some examples, and also getting some, you know, idea about how they're going to charge, and making sure that that's the fixed fee is, I think, super important. Because, you know, unless it's a complicated litigation matter where, you know, it's parties suing and all sorts of things can happen, I don't see a lot of justification in the law to charge on time anymore. I think that, right, that, yeah, if you can describe the scope of the work really well, you need to you should be able to say what that cost is. And then really, you know, asking as well, I think, for, you know, can you talk to some of their clients? Like, yeah, any lawyer, you know, that's done some good work for clients should have people that would be willing to vouch for them and say that they've given great advice. So, you know, asking that question as well is a great one.
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, that's really important, is to, you know, to be able to talk to somebody else, to also learn about, you know, what have you been using them for, right? Because ideally, yep, you want to work with a lawyer who doesn't really go to court a lot because everything has been dealt with, right? But I think that people are, you know, I find that, like, lawyers, doctors, and accountants are in this really weird demographic that business owners almost have this fear of, you know, challenging them on a question or going, no, hang on a second. Like, I really need you to sit and take some time and talk to me about this because I don't understand. And I think it goes to the other side of those people like yourself and me, who are the lawyers and the accountants, who are so used to being in that genre that it just all kind of makes sense to us. And we forget that other people don't know what we know.
Absolutely. Yeah, you get so, caught up in what you do day to day that you forget that the other person, this is probably the biggest legal thing they've ever dealt with in their life. And that comes to another point, Tanya, and that's around, you really want to have a lawyer and any professional that you get along with as well. Like, you don't want to have an adversarial relationship with your consultants. You want someone who is aligned with you, that you can have a chat to, that you can be personable with. Otherwise, you're not going to want to call them. You're not going to want to do that work. You know, my best clients, when I very rarely now put my legal hat on, but when I do, are people that are friends as well, because I want to be able to help them. And there's a thought out there that you don't want to have that personal relationship. And I don't think anything could be further from the truth, because people aren't going to trust your advice. People aren't going to, you know, get what they need from you if you can't have a conversation with them. And I think that becomes a very, very important part of getting advice from any consultant.
Yeah. I love that, because I think that's important for people to, you know, especially entrepreneurs, to hear. And I agree with that, because a lot of my clients, I do have, you know, as I'm thinking through it, and I'm like, yeah, I do have personal relationships with a lot of, because I enjoy working with them, and yep, I work harder for them because of that relationship, because I'm like, I want to see you succeed, right? Because if you succeed, I succeed. So the bigger I can make you, more money comes in my pocket. Like, it's, you know, let's ride this bus together.
Absolutely. And yeah, I wish more professionals had that attitude, because I reckon that there's a lot of work that's left on the table because they don't want to build that relationship.
Yeah. So let's talk about some of the resources that you have for our listeners.
Yeah, so we have, I've put together a page, Business Legal Lifecycle /Fox Talks. And on that page, there's access to a bunch of our resources. And we also put together an online test that people can take. And it really identifies the legal risks within your business. It identifies what are the big gaps that you need to get. And you get a report at the end. It's a PDF that talks about where you are in the business legal lifecycle. It talks about what you're missing in your business from a legal perspective, and it also tells you what you need to do in the future as well. And it's designed for you to take to your lawyer to say, here, these are the gaps that are in my business. And if you don't have a lawyer, then we actually have a referral service. We have a network around the world where we can actually connect people with lawyers to help them out. So that's what they get. And as a thank you for being on here, we normally charge $97 for that. People can get that for half price. So we have that. We also have lots of free resources. There's over 500 pages of content. We've recently been rebuilding the website, and I was like, yeah, going through that with the website builders, and I was actually surprised at how much content there is there. There's over 500 pages of content answering questions of what people need, and we're constantly building more of that. We're constantly building more resources to answer the questions that people have about law, lawyers, and all the rest of that. So people can get access to that. And as I said, we created a page, businesslegallifecycle.com/foxtalks, so people can see that resources quite easily.
So let's flip to you as a business owner. What is on the horizon for you? What do you have your eyes set on for yourself as some goals?
Yeah, so my 2022 goals are very specific to building this business. So I want to get out as much as I can. We're coming to the end, hopefully, fingers crossed, of the pandemic. In Australia, we've had some very strict border rules where we haven't been allowed to leave the country. Whether you like them or agree with them or not, that's the rules. And yep. So hopefully 2022 will be a year where I can get back overseas and I can go and talk a lot about what we're doing. I've been doing a lot of podcast interviews. I love the podcast medium. I've been on great podcasts like yours, Tanya, where we can talk to people about what we're doing. But 2022 is really around just getting the message out there about what we've got available for people, and really showing people what they can do. And we've just released a education course that people can take where they can learn more about the law. And our tagline for that is, you can understand the law without a law degree. And so it's really around getting that out there as much as we can so that people can learn what they need to do and fill those legal gaps in their business. So, yeah.
Well, and I think there's a lot of people that want to do that. I mean, maybe that would be a good thing for those people that really love watching the law shows on TV and thinking that they can take that information and use it in the real world, forgetting that they're not real lawyers.
That's right. And I think that the danger comes from, you've got to educate yourself. And then when you, with knowledge comes, it becomes dangerous. I feel that I am a dangerous tech person. I know enough about technology to really muck it up and and I see that with people with the law, that they know just enough to give them that hubris, to give them that arrogance where they go, there's a big, using a complicated word, hubris, I shouldn't use that word, arrogance, and they think that they know what they're doing, but they don't get that nuanced advice. And so, I think that's something that people could really educate themselves so that they know the questions to answer. That's something that we're very big on.
I just had another question that popped into my mind, and this is like, I said before the interview, there might be a rabbit hole and I will jump down it. So here's one of the rabbit holes I'm going to jump down. So one of the things I was thinking of is, some people have contracts in place, because I know I'm thinking of this now, and I'm thinking I'm guilty of this, that they have had for a long time. How often should you have your contracts reviewed and not just continuously use the same one from 10, 15 years ago? Because one of mine is that old. I'm thinking it's had some tweaks, but not somebody professional looking at it.
So I'll give the great lawyer answer that people love, and it depends. It's the answer. And it depends on the contract, depends what it's for. I would say every couple of years if it's a major contract, and it does depend. It depends on the circumstances. You'll notice that, you know, all the big social media platforms update their terms and conditions, their policies all the time. So the law changes regularly. So if it's a major contract where you've got, you know, and your business is reliant upon it every couple of years, and that could just be that you have a read of it and, you know, and think through, does this actually work for me? If the clients stop paying me tomorrow, could I actually, you know, go and enforce this? And if you're not sure, get it to a lawyer. Again, a good lawyer will charge you a fixed fee to review that type of agreement. And if it's really that important to your business, it's worth that investment of time and money to do that. And so, yeah, I'd say every couple of years, because the laws do change. And depending on what's in the contract, you want to make sure that it's still enforceable. And so, yeah, as I said, it shouldn't be a big investment of money to get that done.
I'll have to put that on my to-do list, because I think there is one that is like, you know, a membership contract, and it's, I don't think it's been looked at, I want to say over 15 years.
Yeah.
We've been lucky that it's never really been an issue, but
and it might be fine. It might be fine too, Tanya. It's just a matter of, you know, giving you that comfort. If it's a really important one, you want to get that reviewed. It's like terms and conditions. You know, a lot of businesses, especially small businesses, have terms and conditions. They've probably got them from somewhere else. They've probably never had it looked at by a lawyer. But even if they have, well, in Australia and around the world, there's lots of privacy policies out there, right? And they change them all the time. Just look at the GDPR in Europe, and you've got the California version of that too. And so you need to make sure that it's your agreements are fit for purpose. And so, unfortunately, the law does change every, you know, 2 to 5 years. And so you just want to make sure that they're right. So it's worthwhile getting it checked out. But in that process, you've got to explain to the lawyer why you want it reviewed and what your concerns are, so that they can then understand what advice you need. And that's where coming in and educating yourself about what all the different terms are, what it all means, is really important. You don't, you know, the worst thing for a lawyer is for you to throw an agreement and them and say, is this enforceable? because they will, you know, they'll probably say, yeah, sure, but they may not understand why you're asking that question. So, you know, getting clear on what your concerns are is really, really important.
And I think it just all circles back to having a point of this is why it's important to be proactive about this stuff. So you have somebody on your side that can look at that, you know, and that you're not, you know, that the relationship is you're excited to go and see them because you're like, hey, my business is growing. I think this contract needs to be looked at, and it's a good, like, you're excited to go and see them. It's not like, hey, I'm being sued. Can I have a meeting? You know, it's like going to the dentist. You just want to go and be like, you have no cavities, you know, <That's> <Woo-hoo!" right. laughs> you know, that's the relationship that we need to, you know, all start having on the legal side. Because I think that, you know, I was excited to have you on the show because I think this is an important thing that a lot of business owners don't think about, or it's something that they always put aside, because it can, you know, have that negative connotation to it. But there's a lot of stuff that you need help with, or, you know, shouldn't be relying just on Googling stuff.
Yeah.
To see if as I said, doing it right.
Googling is a great start. Google, yeah, to educate yourself, but then you need to go and get the advice from a lawyer. The technology is not there to just use generic stuff off the internet yet. You know, I know there's lots of great services out there. I know people use them, and that they're a great starting point, but it still doesn't do the nuance that you need for your business and doesn't necessarily protect you. So yeah, you can use them as a starting point, but then get advice from your lawyer, I think is the message that I would give to the listeners.
So if there's people out there and they're like, I like this guy, I like the cut of his jib, I want to learn more about him, where's the best place for them to start stalking you online?
So I'm very active on LinkedIn. So if people search for my name on LinkedIn, I'm the only one who spells my name that way that I've found so far with Streten. It's an unusual last name spelling. So, and one of the advantages of that is that you get unique on social media. So there, and also if people go to the website I said before, businesslegallifecycle.com/foxtalks, they'll have the resources for fans of the show. And we'll also have lots of other resources that they can get access to there.
Perfect. Well, Jeremy, thank you so much for, you know, I don't want to say dumbing it down, but that it's exactly what it is. And it's, I think it's really a comfort. And I think there's a lot of stuff for people, including myself. Yes, I promise I will go and get that contract looked at again, but a good reminder for people, especially as, you know, we're coming into the new year and people are looking at expanding and changing. Now is the perfect time to make sure that you have this set up.
Yes. And thank you so much for having me on, Tanya.
Thank you so much for tuning in today, Foxy listeners. Don't forget to head to our website, foxtalksbusiness.ca. Click on blogs on the left-hand side of the page, and you will see all of the ways that you can connect with Jeremy, buy his book, and all of the other fun resources that he has for us. So no matter what you're doing today, whether you are trying to figure out legal speak or just buying Jeremy's book to make it a lot easier, make sure that you find time to have fun. Because as I always say, if you're not having fun, why are you doing it?